Hi, it's Kiffin LeBates here, and today I want to talk about why smart contracts can't digitally sign stuff. And to understand why that is, you have to understand a bit about Ethereum addresses and the difference between contract addresses and externally owned accounts. Those are addresses that are in your wallet, say your MetaMask wallet. So on surface investigation, a contract address and an externally owned account address look the same. They both start with 0x, that's to indicate that what is following is a hexadecimal number, and then they're followed by 40 characters, either the digits 0 to 9 or the letters A to F. And the reason for that is that the 40 digit number is in hexadecimal, and hexadecimal is the number system that we would use for counting if we had evolved to have 16 fingers instead of 10. So that A, B, C, D, E, or F is actually a digit, even though we're using a letter from the alphabet. So there you have it. The two look identical. You can't tell by looking at an address whether it is an externally owned account address or whether it is a smart contract. To distinguish between the two, you would actually have to go and dig into the blockchain and see if a contract had been deployed at that address. Then you would know it was a contract. Or if there had been some signed transactions recorded on the Ethereum blockchain, that would tell you that it was definitely an externally owned account. If you can't find it present on the blockchain, then you have no idea whether it is a smart contract or whether it is something with a human being behind it clicking OK on transactions. So why are they different then if they look the same? Well, it's about how they're derived. If you create a new address in your blockchain wallet, what happens is your blockchain wallet generates a 256-bit random number that is used as the private key for a signing algorithm called ECDSA, and a public address is then generated by your wallet, and then that is hashed using the KEKAK hash function, and that produces 256 bits, and then the last 160 bits are taken, and that is your Ethereum address. And 160 bits is 40 characters in hexadecimal, because each hexadecimal character represents 4 bits. Hopefully I haven't lost you with all those numbers. Feel free to pause, go back and re-listen to that again. So that's your Ethereum address. And the way that the Ethereum blockchain can determine that a transaction coming from a given address is valid is by looking at the signature. From the signature, you can extract the public key. You can then KEKAK 256 hash that, take the last 40 characters or 160 bits, and check that they correspond with the Ethereum address that's being referenced. And if they are, you know that's a valid digital signature for that address. Now, for smart contracts, it's a bit different. What happens is when someone deploys a smart contract, the contract address is generated at that point in a deterministic manner. And there are actually two ways of doing that. There's a create command and there is a create to command. I'm just going to talk about the first one. There, the contract address is created by taking the address of the deployer, appending a nonce to it. That's a number used only once, so it's incremented each time somebody deploys a contract, and then hashing that and taking the last 40 hex characters or 160 bits. So it's completely deterministic. You can look at an Ethereum address that is an externally owned account, and you can say the first smart contract that this address deploys will have this address, the second one will have this address, and so on and so forth. But the thing here is that the addresses of the smart contract therefore don't have a private key, or rather they do have a private key, but we're not going to be able to find it, because trying to find the private key that creates an address corresponding to the address of the smart contract is, you know, so small that it's pretty much zero. So the smart contract doesn't have a private key. So then the question might be, well, how does the smart contract therefore have the authority to do stuff on the blockchain? And the way it has the authority is because it's living on the blockchain. You can kind of think of an externally owned account as being like having a visa to visit the land of Ethereum and be allowed to do things in that land. And You can think of smart contracts as being natives within the land of Ethereum, and by virtue of their citizenship, they're allowed to do the stuff that it says in the rules of their contract code. So smart contracts, generally speaking, don't need to have private keys because they're authorized to do the stuff that is encoded in their code. There is no need for digital signing. And in fact, it wouldn't work to have smart contracts having their own private key because they're on the blockchain. The blockchain is transparent. You can see exactly what data is on there. So if they were to sign stuff, they'd need the private key. The private key would need to be on the blockchain, and therefore anybody would be able to see it. So that mechanism wouldn't work. And that's kind of why Ethereum has gone with the model that it has. Smart contracts are on the blockchain. By virtue of being on the blockchain, they're authorized to do what their code says they're allowed to do, and that's that. What else was I going to talk about? I think there was a final thing I wanted to summarize, which so I mentioned the fact that an Ethereum address can have many, many different private keys. In practice, we're unlikely to be able to find multiple private keys for any given Ethereum address because you have to search through this vast key space. However, the reason why an Ethereum address can have multiple private keys, in theory, is because we're only taking the last 160 bits of that KECAC 256 hash. So when you take a public ECDSA key and you KECAC hash it and you get 256 bits, if you're only taking the last 160 bits to produce the Ethereum address, that means that there are a total of 2 to the power of 160 different possible Ethereum addresses. But there are probably about 2 to the power of 256 ECDSA addresses that produce those addresses, those Ethereum addresses. So there's a many to one mapping there. There have to be multiple ECDSA addresses that produce the same Ethereum address. In fact, for every Ethereum address, let's do a quick calculation. What's 256 minus 160? So it's 96. So there, for every Ethereum address, there will be 2 to the power of 96 different possible private keys that generate that address, approximately. Depends a bit on how the KECAC 256 hash function works and how it maps, how collision resistant it is. But so that may make you think, well, you know, if there are 2 to the power of 96 different possible private keys for every Ethereum address, it should be very easy to find one if there's so many. But the fact is, there are 2 to the power of 160 different addresses. So even though there are a lot of private keys that produce the same Ethereum address, there are an awful lot of Ethereum addresses, far, far more than there are then you have the chance of finding. Not 100% convinced about this video. I think I'll go ahead and post it anyway. I hope you found it interesting. And if you're still curious, you can go and dig around on the internet. There's some interesting articles, or rather answers, on Stack Overflow that go into this kind of stuff. And it does really help to dig in and look at the mechanics of it. It's not a bad place to start addressing, actually, if you're trying to understand a blockchain, because the addressing system and the digital signing is very key part of how a blockchain works. There was one final thing, and it just popped into my head and then I lost it again. Oh well, I'll save it for the next video. I hope you found this one interesting, and I'll see you in that next video soon, when hopefully I'll have remembered what I was going to say. That's it for today. Bye for now.